Good morning. The first item of business is general questions. Question number one has been withdrawn. Question number two, Douglas Lumsden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what measures it has in place to ensure that there is full transparency when it comes to the use of public money.
Minister Tom Arthur.
The Scottish Government is committed to a transparent Scottish budget and has robust controls in place for approving financial expenditure and investment. We comply with all Scottish Parliament and Audit Scotland financial reporting and auditing requirements, providing unqualified accounts since 2007, and work with Parliament and its committees to improve budget scrutiny. The Scottish budget and any in-year revisions are scrutinised by the Parliament, with a minimum of two budget updates being published each year. To support improved transparency, significantly enhanced budget revision information is now provided to assist the Finance and Public Administration Committee.
Douglas Lumsden.
Minister, we have seen huge amounts of public money flow from the Government to the Scottish National Investment Bank and then invested, some of which, as we learned from the Economy Committee yesterday, is now lost. When legislation was passed, it mandated that ministers establish an advisory group to oversee the bank's objectives, conduct and performance. So can I ask, was this group ever created? If not, why not? And if it hasn't been created, is the bank operating illegally?
Minister.
Well, I would first of all want to recognise the excellent work that the Scottish National Investment Bank has been undertaken since its establishment in supporting a range of businesses and economic activity right across Scotland. Of course, in government we are committed to, as are all public bodies, the highest standards. On the specific points that the member raises, I am happy to come back to him in writing on the specific details of these points. But as I say, and as in regards to my original question, we are committed to the high standards of transparency on all matters pertaining to the use of public money.
Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Does the Minister agree with me that it really is farcical for a member of the Conservative Party to stand up in any chamber in these islands and ask about transparency relating to the use of public money when his London bosses wasted billions during COVID and hand out peerages for donations?
Minister.
Well, I think the member makes a very important point, and I think fundamentally what there is with the Conservatives, and it's unsurprising, is a complete lack of self-awareness. But if one is a member of a party that has inflicted austerity upon so many people, if one is a member of a party that inflicts the rape clause on so many people, if one is a member of a party that takes an appalling policy towards migrants and small boats, then perhaps a lack of self-awareness and a detachment from reality is the only way one can live with oneself.
Before I move on to the next question, I would say to the member who has just put that question to please in future bear in mind the need for matters to relate to those for which the Scottish Government has general responsibility. I call Jackie Bailey.
The truth, Presiding Officer, is that both governments operate on the basis of appearing to be secretive and lacking in transparency. Papers from NHS Highlands suggest that there is a projected overspend of £1 billion in the Scottish Government's health budget, but ministers remain in a state of denial. The lack of transparency makes it difficult to follow that movement of money. So will the minister publish a detailed financial explanation of how these pressures have arisen and what action will be taken?
Minister.
I stood in Parliament last week and reported on the provisional outturn. I have appeared numerous times before the Finance and Public Administration Committee on budget revision matters. And indeed, we do publish full consolidated accounts which have received unqualified audits for every year that we have had an SNP-led government in Scotland. So we provide an abundance of information to ensure the utmost transparency on matters of public finance. And of course, as I have said previously, I am committed to continued engagement with the Finance and Public Administration Committee and any member who happens to be interested in these matters to ensure that we can improve and enhance on the transparency of public finances in Scotland.
Question number three, Ash Regan.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the visual recorded interviews pilot, which involves Police Scotland recording the witness statements of adult and 16 and 17-year-old complainers involving allegations of rape and attempted rape, including any learning from the cases involved as they progressed through the court system.
Minister Siobhan Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This two-year pilot funded by the Scottish Government concluded in May 2022. Where appropriate, the aim of the pilot is for the Crown Office and the Procurator Fiscal Service to use these interviews as a complainer's evidence should the case proceed to trial, and to make an associated application to facilitate the cross-examination of the complainer by means of an evidence by commissioner hearing. We are carrying out an interim review of the pilot, and when sufficient numbers of cases involved from the pilot progress to trial, we will complete a full and meaningful evaluation.
Ash Regan.
I thank the Minister for that response. I think everyone would probably agree that there are very clear benefits to complainers in not being re-traumatised by the continual retelling of their story over and over and over again. And for those that might be interested in this, it's illustrated very well by the TV true crime series Unbelievable, which shows both the compassionate and the not so compassionate treatment of victims of these type of crimes. Now, this type of video recorded evidence is now standard in many other jurisdictions, and I'm very pleased to see that the Minister is saying that there will be an interim report on the progress, and I'd be very keen to know what the timetable for that interim report would be, and also what the progress is on the potential rollout of this policy across the rest of the country, because it's a key part of improving both evidence gathering and lessening the impact on victims.
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I am in complete agreement with the member. Since only a small number of cases have progressed to trial to date, it is too early for an evaluation to make meaningful assessment. Therefore, it's been agreed that the Justice Analytical Services would undertake an interim review of the pilot. While the pilot has formally concluded, VRI still operates within the areas that form part of the pilot approach, with training continuing to be rolled out by Police Scotland. An internal evaluation of the pilot has been undertaken and will be signed off once the assessment has been completed by COPFS. I will get back to the member on the timescales.
Question number four, Martin Whitfield.
Very grateful, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what support it will give in the academic year 2023-24 for the Rights Respecting School Awards programme.
Minister Natalie Dawn.
In May 2022, the Scottish Government awarded UNICEF UK a three-year grant to offer their Rights Respecting School Award to all state, primary, secondary and special education needs schools in Scotland. During this period, the costs of participating in the programme are met at a national level rather than by individual schools or local authorities. This has removed local financial barriers to participation and secured an offer for all schools with significant public sector efficiency savings. In the financial year 23-24, UNICEF UK will receive £300,000 from the Scottish Government for this purpose.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to the Minister for that answer, and it is right to say that this scheme has reached out to 57% of schools, and 563 of our institutions have both silver or gold stage awards. And it is right to say that registration will remain free until March 2025. However, some of the lesson plans and equipment that are needed come at a cost of £175 and more, which need to be met by the school themselves. Understanding their rights is fundamental to a child in Scotland understanding their place here. So would the Minister agree with me that the learning of these rights is somewhat challenged by the position with regard to the UNCRC bill, on which they are unable to pursue some of their rights, and when will we see a change in this?
Minister.
I think myself and colleagues have affirmed our commitment to the UNCRC bill on multiple occasions, and the delay to the UNCRC bill need not and should not prevent schools from building that rights-respecting culture. As well as the Rights Respecting School Award, we are aware of other great practice underway in schools, including through the Dignity in Schools programme, which is delivered by the Children's Parliament. Education Scotland have also developed a professional learning module that aims to raise awareness and develops knowledge and understanding of the UNCRC. It helps establishments to self-evaluate their practice in light of the UNCRC and supports improvement planning within establishments.
Question number five, Christine Graham.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on whether child minding development officers have a significant role to play in supporting and assisting child minders in their professional development.
Minister Natalie Dawn.
The Scottish Government recognises and values the unique role that childminders play in delivering early learning and childcare to families across Scotland and is of course keen to see our childminders supported in their professional capacity. I am therefore supportive of any additional support and assistance that is made available to our ELC professionals at local levels to aid their professional development.
Christine Graham.
I thank the Minister for her answer and I share her views on the valuable contributions of childminders. I refer to written answer S6W19156 to me dated 21st June this year, advising that Scottish Borders currently has a childminding development officer contracted through the Scottish Childminding Association to Scottish Borders Council. Unfortunately, local childminders have advised me this position is not to be renewed, which causes them and me concern. Does the Minister agree?
Minister.
As the childminding development officers are SCMA employees contracted to work with local authorities, any employment or contracting decisions regarding these roles would be a matter for the relevant local authority and SCMA to determine. However, childminders are such a hugely valued part of our ELC sector, and I would encourage local authorities as commissioners of services to continually consider what support is available for them at local level. For its part, the Scottish Government is working very closely with the SCMA to promote childminding. We have supported a successful childminder recruitment pilot aiming to recruit and train 100 new childminders in remote and rural communities, with a second phase now trialling the recruitment model in urban communities. We're also piloting activity with the SCMA across six local authorities to support childminders with streamlining and therefore reducing the administrative burdens associated with our practice. And we will continue to work with sector representatives.
Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The problem isn't professional development, it is trying to encourage people to enter and stay within the childcare profession. The Scottish Childminding Association said 34% of childminders had quit since funding was increased for early education and childcare in 2016. By 2026, this figure is expected to have risen to 64%. I know the Minister shares my passion in early years, so can I ask her whether she will update Parliament on any progress her government has made to tackle these worrying statistics?
Minister.
I thank the member for that question. The Scottish Government is working to increase the number of childminders operating across Scotland, and this work includes supporting the innovative SCMA-led Scottish Rural Childminding Partnership recruitment model and its extension into urban areas. This pilot offers a package of fully funded support and training available to successful applicants, providing everything needed to establish a new childminding business from home. As I've said, childminders are a hugely valuable part of our ELC sector, not only in their involvement in funded ELC, but they will have an absolutely vital role to play as we deliver our programme for government commitments to extend funded early learning and build that system of school-age childcare. We'll continue to work with the SCMA, other sector representatives and statutory bodies to address the issues that are affecting recruitment and retention, including reducing administrative burdens.
Craig Hoy.
Is the loss of funding for the SCMA's Childminding Support Officer in the Scottish Borders not only deeply regrettable, but isn't it also an example of SNP council cuts? Yep. Will the Minister therefore now agree to look again at the support they give councils to discharge their 1140 hours plan, both through childminding and nursery provision?
Minister.
Yes, I think I've been clear in terms of my support for this, and childminders, as I've said, are such a hugely valuable part of our ELC sector, and I'm always happy to consider any proposals which would aid the delivery of the Scottish Government's policy on early learning and childcare. However, these posts that the members referred to support delivery within local areas, and I would want to see local authorities as commissioners of services consider priority in their areas in the first instance.
Question 6 is not lodged. Question 7, Claire Baker.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government how it is promoting and encouraging an increase in employee-owned and cooperative models of businesses as part of a shift to a wellbeing economy.
Minister, Cabinet Secretary Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I must first declare an interest as a cooperative member myself. As we approach tomorrow's Employee Ownership Day, I thank Claire Baker for highlighting the importance of Scotland's thriving cooperative and employee-owned businesses. Cooperatives and inclusive business models play a critical role in economic recovery, supporting the Scottish Government's aim to create a fairer, stronger and more democratic wellbeing economy. Cooperative Development Scotland, funded through Scottish Enterprise, continues to work to raise awareness of the value of cooperative and employee ownership models and provides specialist advice and support to businesses and community groups who want to adopt those models.
Claire Baker.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. In March 22, there were 195 employee-owned businesses operating in Scotland, compared with around 100 in 2018. At that pace, it will take at least another 12 years to meet the target of 500, rather than the 7 years that the Government has left to meet the 2030 deadline. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary if he could provide an update on the review of how to significantly increase employee-owned businesses, which they committed to in the programme for government, and what related action is going to take place in this year to kick-start the significant increase we all want to see?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I'm happy to. As we set out in the National Strategy for Economic Transformation and the programme for government in 22-23 that Claire Baker refers to, a review will be conducted of how to support Scotland's social enterprise, cooperative and employee-owned business sectors to grow. The review will commence in autumn this year with an initial pre-review stakeholder discussion to be held this month. And this initial meeting will be chaired by my colleague, the Minister for Community Wealth and Public Finance.
Ivan McKee.
As the Cabinet Secretary has rightly identified, tomorrow is Employee Ownership Day, where thousands of employee owners, employee-owned businesses and supporters of employee ownership from across Scotland and the UK come together to raise awareness of the benefits and impact of employee-owned businesses. And I've been delighted this week to host in the Parliament an exhibition by Scotland for Employee Ownership, Corporate Development Scotland, Scottish Enterprise and the Employee Ownership Association in the Garden Lobby, and I would commend members to visit that, that stand. So I would like to ask the Cabinet Secretary what the Scottish Government is doing to celebrate and promote Employee Ownership Day.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you. I thank Ivan McKee for supporting this week's exhibition, the work he did in his previous role to support this sector, and joining him in commending to all members. The Minister for Community Wealth, Building and Public Finance, Tom Arthur, as co-chair of Scotland for Employee Ownership, met yesterday with fellow board members, including the Employee Ownership Association. As well as supporting this week's exhibition, the board discussed plans for further events later in the year.
Thank you. Question number 8, Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of whether its target for a one-third reduction in food waste by 2025 will be met.
Minister Gillian Martin.
Officer, the Scottish Government's commitment to reduce food waste will deliver waste reduction while maximising carbon savings. Based on robust waste compositional analysis, we aim to publish an estimate on food waste levels in Scotland in the coming months. This will help inform our understanding and progress against our 2025 target. It will also inform proposals in the upcoming waste route map and refreshed food waste reduction action plan, both due for publication this year.
Maurice Golden.
I thank the Minister for that answer, but earlier this week the Cabinet Secretary was unable to say how much the average food waste reduction has been each year since 2016 when the target was set. It needs to be approximately 33,000 tonnes per year. When setting the target, the Scottish Government would clearly know that. So can the Minister, very easy question, actually tell the figure to the Chamber today?
Minister.
Well, I would say that one of the reports that gives an indication of our, as I suppose, our achievements in reducing food waste is the Scottish Waste from All Sources report that was from SEPA, which reported that food waste had fallen to record low levels. However, the Scottish Government is committed to improving consistency of food waste data to better inform our reduction efforts. You'll know that the cyber attack on SEPA in 2020 significantly impacted on food waste recycling data collection. Secondly, obtaining frequent accurate food waste data takes time and can be expensive, so we're working to secure accurate food waste data through obtaining a waste compositional analysis led by Zero Waste Scotland and SEPA, and this analysis will inform the Food Waste Reduction Action Plan review, which is due this year.
We'll have a brief pause before we move on to the next item of business.